In a previous video, I demonstrated how tap water reacts with electronic circuits. Along the way, we concluded that an Arduino Pro Mini boards will not work reliably underwater without the help of a protection against the water. That is when I coated the Arduino in an unknown substance, which was actually just plain old nail polish. After letting it dry, it protects the circuit from the water, and thus it functions without a problem. For simple and small circuits, this method is suitable, and seems to not influence the electrical connections negatively. But let's say we have an ESC that we want to operate underwater. Now, in case you don't know, an ESC is an electrical circuit that connects in between a BLDC motor and a power source and controls the revolution speed of the motor according to an input signal. Here it is not only important to protect the electrical connections from water, but also guarantee that the coating material can handle the heat transfer from the heatsink. So in this video we are going to test out nail polish, silicone and potting compounds to see which material is best suited for this job. Let's get started! This video is sponsored by JLC PCB, a manufacturer of quick PCB prototypes for 10 years. Upload your Gerber files to get high quality PCBs for ridiculously low prices, and make your projects look more professional. To start this experiment, I unpacked three identical ESCs whose label and heat shrink tubing I removed afterwards. To make sure they all work properly, I connected each to a motor and a power source and utilized my homemade ESC tester to see whether they would all work, which they did. So I got myself a few Type K thermocouples, which are basically just two metal wires connected together in one point in order to create a voltage difference proportional to the temperature, and secured them to the heatsinks of the ESCs with Kapton tape. By utilizing the compatible thermometer circuits, we can easily measure the temperature of the heatsink, which went up to 27.5 degrees Celsius after letting the motor rotate for around 10 minutes, with an input signal of 1.5 milliseconds. This will be our reference temperature for later. For the first test, I went with the nail polish, which does work on one side without a problem. But it should be fairly obvious that this method brings some problems when it comes to completely encapsulating the ESC plus its heatsink. But anyway, after I then submerged the ESC and connected the input signal and power, I noticed that the ESC still worked without a problem. But while letting the motor rotate for 10 minutes, I also noticed that its speed was fluctuating and bubbles were produced by the ESC. Those were all not positive signs, but the motor still rotated successfully for 10 minutes while the ESC reached a temperature of 20.6 degrees Celsius. And after repeating the test in air, the ESC reached a temperature of 28.2 degrees Celsius. Not as low as without the coats, but that was to be expected. The important question is, how will the other two materials perform? To find that out, I used a sheet of rigid foam on which I marked the outlines for all the pieces of two cuboids in which the ESCs would fit. Then I cut out all the pieces with a box cutter and used hot glue to connect them to one another. And I made sure to use plenty of hot glue in order to guarantee that the constructions were waterproof. Once that was done, I prepared a tube of high temperature silicone and covered the bottom of the first cuboid with it. Afterwards, I pressed the ESC into it and then buried it underneath another layer of silicone. And while that was drying, I got myself the two components for the potting compound, which is the stuff that manufacturers usually utilize to waterproof electronics or hide their circuits from your sight. I doubt that many viewers can read the German warning text on the bottles, so let me summarize it. Be super careful when dealing with this stuff, and protective gloves and glasses are mandatory. For my mixture, I utilize shot glasses to measure 4 centiliters of component B and 8 centiliters of component A, which I then poured into a small silicone bucket. After mixing the two components together for 3 minutes with a plastic stirrer at a speed of 450 RPM, I let it sit for around 2 minutes and then poured it into the second cuboid in which I positioned the ESC beforehand. Now after one day of waiting, the silicone and the potting compound were hardened. But it was quite obvious that there was something wrong with the silicone. So I tried to free the rigid foam pieces from the silicone, which revealed that the inside was still liquid, which forced me to add a bit more silicone and wait for another day. After repeating this process a second time, the silicone coat was finally complete. And after reattaching the motor, submerging the silicone covered ESC and powering it all, it looked like everything still worked flawlessly. So I repeated the same temperature measurement underwater and in air, which ultimately delivered values which were pretty close to the previous ones. Not bad. To finish this experiment, I freed the potting compound from the cuboid walls, which was this time a lot easier to accomplish. The result of the potting compound was certainly not perfect, but nevertheless it looked quite fascinating. And after once again reattaching the motor and power and submerging the ESC, it turned out to work just fine as well. The last thing to do was to repeat the by now well-known temperature measurement, which also delivered values pretty similar to the previous ones. So all in all, the three methods are capable of waterproofing electronics, while simultaneously featuring sufficient heat transfer capabilities. Personally though, I would recommend nail polish for small and mechanical unstressed projects, since it is so quick and easy to use. And potting compounds for more complex projects, since it is truly the professional way of waterproofing electronics, and can also withstand a lot of mechanical stress. Silicone though was a bit too messy for my taste, and is due to its viscosity rather difficult to apply evenly. And with that being said, you should now have a good idea of how to waterproof electronics effectively. If you like this video, don't forget to like, share and subscribe. Stay creative, and I will see you next time.